Hi everyone, welcome back to integralcalc.com. Today we're going to be doing a surface area of revolution problem. This one, we're given the equation y equals x squared minus 1/8 ln, or the natural log of x, and we're asked to evaluate the surface area of revolution between the points where x equals 1 and x equals 2, and we're revolving around the y-axis. So we've got our y-axis and we're revolving the graph around the y-axis this way. Between x equals 1 and x equals 2. So let's go ahead and take a look at what this is going to look like. Depending on which axis you're revolving around, whether it's the y-axis, the x-axis, and the form in which you're given your equation, that's going to change your formula a little bit. In this case, because we're revolving around the y-axis and we're given this the equation in this form, we put our x right here, everything else stays the same as the standard formula for surface area of revolution. So this x is what's important to pay attention to when we're revolving around the y-axis. We put the x here. So we're going to be using that formula, and the first thing that we want to do, just to simplify things for ourselves, we're given our equation in the form y equals something. But in our formula here, we have f of x. It's the same thing, but I just want to go ahead and change the notation to f of x so that we don't get confused. So I just swapped out y for f of x instead. And now what I can go ahead and do is work on this piece right here in the formula. I want to first take the derivative, because we're looking at f prime of x, and then square it, because this is kind of tricky in here. So I want to get this whole piece in place and then just plug it right into the formula. So I'm going to go ahead and do that. And the first thing I'll do is take the derivative of f of x. So for f prime of x, of course here x squared, we multiply the 2 out in front and we get 2x. And then this 1/8 coefficient stays here. The derivative of the natural log of x is, of course, 1 over x, so we multiply the 1/8 by 1 over x, and then when we simplify, our derivative is going to end up being 2x minus 1 over 8x, which is what we get when we combine this 1/8 and 1 over x. So this here is our derivative. So now we have f prime of x. Let's go ahead and square it before we plug it into this part of the formula. So when we square it, obviously, you know, you can see we're going to square both sides here. Now we can go ahead and simplify the right-hand side before we plug it into our formula. And when we do that, you know, we'll square this whole thing. So you'll have 2x minus 1 over 8x times another 2x minus 1 over 8x. And when you multiply everything together, when you FOIL it or whatever you want to call it, you get 4x squared minus 1/2 plus 1 over 64 x squared. So this is now f prime of x squared. You can see here this part matches exactly what we have up here. So now we know we can go ahead and plug it in to our formula. So when we do that, this is what we get here. This, our area formula, we're going to plug in our limits here, our upper and lower bounds, 1 and 2 for a and b. So we plugged in 1 and 2. We leave 2 pi x alone because that's part of our formula. And then I plugged in this whole thing under the square root sign, but I skipped one step here. You'll notice that we have 1 plus f prime of x squared. So I did 1 plus this whole piece right here. When we do 1 plus a negative 1/2, we get a positive 1/2. So I just went ahead and combined those. So what you end up with under the square root when you take this part and you add 1 is this 4x squared plus 1 over 64x squared plus 1/2. So this is now our integral, and now we have to start simplifying before we can integrate and solve. So the way that we're going to do that, and the easiest way to solve these kinds of problems, is to try to find a common denominator for everything under the square root sign. So in this case, our lowest common denominator is going to be 64x squared. So we're going to multiply each term by whatever we need to get 64x squared in the denominator. So in this case, and one thing here we did too, we moved the 2 pi out in front of the integral, which is a really good thing to do in all of these kinds of problems because this 2 pi is just a constant. It can be moved out in front of the integral, and it simplifies what you have to integrate. It's less for you to look at, so it'll make it easier. But we leave the x, and now back to finding the lowest common denominator. So in the case of this 4x squared term, we have to multiply by 64x squared over 64x squared to get 64x squared in the denominator. So we do that. We can leave this term alone. It's already got the lowest common denominator of these three terms. And for the 1/2, we have to multiply by 32x squared over 32x squared in order to get 64x squared in the denominator. So we set that up, and now we'll multiply everything together. Everything stays the same, but now in our square root sign here, we end up with three terms, all with 64x squared in the denominator, which means that we can combine those three terms into one, and we just have 64x squared in the denominator, and we end up with 256x to the fourth, which is this 4x squared here times 64x squared here. This 1 gets pulled out right here, and we end up with 32x squared as well here in the numerator. So that's how we simplify what's inside of our square root sign. And now we can do a couple things. Remember that whenever you're dealing with square roots and you have a fraction, just one single fraction inside of your square root, you can kind of treat the numerator and the denominator separately. So the numerator of our fraction is too complicated to immediately take the square root of, but the denominator is simple enough that we can do that. So we notice that the square root of 64 is 8. The square root of x squared is x, which means that the square root of 64x squared is 8x, of course, right? When we have terms multiplied together like that, we can kind of take the square roots separately. So point being that the square root of the denominator is 8x. So we can pull that outside of our square root sign, and we multiply here by 1 divided by 8x. That 8x still has to stay in the denominator because this, of course, is the denominator. So that stays in the denominator, but we can remove it from the square root sign, which means we're just left with the numerator. And in this case, lucky for us, the numerator can be factored into 16x squared plus 1, that whole quantity squared. And that's going to be useful to us because, of course, when we take the square root, that square sign is going to go away. So this is how we pulled out the denominator. We factored the numerator. And now our next simplification step is twofold. First of all, we have a 1/8 here coefficient on this whole integral. We can pull this 1/8 outside with this 2 pi. And when we multiply 1/8 by 2 pi, we're going to end up with pi over 4. So that's how we simplify there. We have the pi over 4. Also, we have here an x in the numerator and an x in the denominator. So those two will cancel and go away completely, which means everything here in front of the square root is going to get simplified out in front of the integral or cancel, and we're just going to be left with the square root of the quantity 16x squared plus 1 squared. So, of course, when we take the square root of that, this squared term here is going to go away, the square root sign goes away, we're just left with 16x squared plus 1. And luckily, that's easy enough that we can integrate. So when we integrate this, of course, the pi over 4 remains out in front. And then remember, to integrate, we're adding 1 to the exponent. So 2 plus 1 is 3, so we get the exponent 3. And then we divide the coefficient 16 by the new exponent, which is 3. So we get 16 thirds x cubed. And then, of course, the integral of 1 is x. And we're going to be evaluating that on the range 1 to 2. So that's what our integral looks like after we evaluate. And now we just need to evaluate by plugging in 1 and 2. So here's what that's going to look like. We've got this definite integral here, and we're going to plug in. Remember, when you have a definite integral, you always plug in the top number, in our case 2, first. And then you always subtract here in the center, and then always plug in the bottom number, in our case 1, to the second half here. So the pi over 4 remains out in front. We just plug in 2, we subtract, and plug in 1. And now we're going to start simplifying. So 2 times 2 is 4, times 2 is 8. 8 times 16 is 128, so that's how we end up with 128 over 3. We leave the 2 by itself. 16 over 3 times 1 cubed is just 16 thirds, so we have a minus 16 thirds. And then this negative sign here carries over to this one term, so we end up with a negative 1. Now we're going to go ahead, we could do this with our calculator, but I want to end up with a clean fraction at the end, so we're going to find a lowest common denominator inside the parentheses here, which means that we're going to multiply both this term, the positive 2, and this negative 1 term by 3 over 3 to get 3s in the denominator. So we end up with a positive 6 thirds and a negative 3 over 3. So now that we've got a lowest common denominator, we can go ahead and combine these fractions here. What we end up with is 115 over 3. And now what we do is multiply these two together, and we end up with 115 pi divided by 12. And that's obviously as far as you can simplify. So that's our final answer. That is the form that you get for your final answer for surface area of revolution. I hope that helps you guys, and I'll see you in the next video. Bye!